Me okay?
Yes.
All right, let's rock and roll today. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Now, the word I'm going to give you today is entitled The Big Picture. I'm going to tell you right now that some of you are going to be offended today. Some of you are not going to like me today, and that's okay. I'm used to that. Amen? As a pastor, I have to tell you the truth. As a pastor, I have to give you the picture the way that God gives it to me. Amen? But I'm also going to tell you, you have a responsibility when you hear the word to go home and study the word and take that word apart, dissect it, analyze it, and get a revelation on it. What's happening today is the beginning of woes in this country. We are going into a very, very dark time. And the church has fallen asleep. And I'm going to wake the church up today. This one. Amen? Okay. So, if you agree with me, fine. If you don't agree with me, fine. Take it up with God. Amen? Okay. Here we go. Ferguson. Baltimore. The Islamic State. Nepal. The jetliner crashing into the mountain. Pastor Saeed. What do they all have in common?
Tragedy. Evil.
Yes.
What is it?
The devil.
The devil. Evil. Amen. That's very good. We are fighting a spiritual battle. How many understand it? The Bible says, does it not, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, rulers of darkness in high places. How many understand that?
Amen.
When you see the news media picking up on racism, there's a little bit of that in America, that there's no question. But the underlying issue is there's a spiritual battle going on. When you saw Martin Luther King back in the day wanting civil rights, you didn't see what you saw in the past few months in these two states, in these two cities. What you saw was lawlessness, recklessness, and rebellion. That's not of God at all. Amen? That's of the enemy. The problem is, church, we don't know what this word of God says. We don't understand God's character. We don't understand God's will. We think that we do, but we don't. As a Christian, you can't come to church, walk in that door, sit in that pew, listen to a message, go home, don't pick up the word, don't pray, don't seek God, and come back next Sunday being full of God's Spirit. That does not work. That does not work. You have to understand, and I'm going to bring this to the teens too, because I don't think the teens truly understand the severity of this. In the Bible, it talks about tribulation, and there is an assumed rapture. Now, I've been taught in churches that we're going to be post-trib, there's a mid-trib belief, and there's a post-trib belief. I don't care what you believe in the rapture, you just need to be ready.
Amen.
The Bible says that not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of God. It's said by the Gallup poll that 85% of the American people today consider themselves Christians. However, church, when I go to minister to these so-called Christians, I'm considered a Jesus freak and a holy roller and an offense.
Yes.
So my question is, Christian, 85% Christian, if I'm preaching the word of God to you, why are you getting so upset?
Amen.
Unless your father is actually the devil.
Amen.
And not the father that I serve.
Yeah.
You get that?
Yeah.
Teens, what you have to remember is you're not going to heaven based on what mom and dad do.
Yeah.
Understand this. Understand this. You're not going to make it because of mom and dad's holiness or their relationship. God's going to look at each one of your hearts and know exactly where you stand, who and what you love, and what you desire. So don't think that you have a free ticket going to heaven if you should die before your time. Because God's going to judge your heart. When the rapture happens and mom and dad go, you could technically be left behind.
Yeah.
Because you don't care. It's not important to you. You better make God a first priority in your life.
Amen.
Amen? You need to be ready in case that you die at any point in time, because people always tell me, Pastor, young people, they shouldn't die. I just went to a funeral 5 months ago of a 23-year-old. Yeah. Went way too early.
Wow.
On a freak accident. That wasn't supposed to happen either. I see crosses on the side of the road of young people who are driving too fast under the influence or whatever it was with crosses. They weren't supposed to go that young either. But listen to me, church. When you die, do you know where you're going? There is a spiritual battle going on for your very souls. You have to understand that. Everything that's happening today is a spiritual battle. What side are you on? ISIS strikes fear into people. Well, I'm going to give you a little bit more. I read an article this past week that ISIS sent a letter or notification to our security department in Washington that they now are in 5 states.
Yes.
Virginia, Illinois, Iowa, Michigan, two other ones. I don't know.
Texas,
and where else? I think it's California. Listen to me and listen well. The end is starting. This country, when it kills unborn babies at record numbers, it allows homosexuality to run rampant, and that's okay, and that's accepted. Everything's accepted. I'm not. Listen to me. We love them, but now when you pull the law of God away and you do what God says don't do, now his covering gets lifted. This country is on the cusp of reaping and weeping, pulling God out. The Bible says when much is given, much is required. Amen? ISIS is in 5 states. That we know of. Amen? Nepal, earthquake, tsunamis, weather patterns, everything going completely contrary to what God had established, because we live in a fallen world. These things are going to continue. Every time you put the TV on, there's some other major disaster taking place. And people still don't turn to God and say, Lord, help us. The church still decides it's going to sleep and not sound the alarm because God is going to take care of everything. Listen, if you think your family members are going to get saved automatically, you are dead wrong.
Yes.
You need to preach the word to them.
Amen.
Thank you. One person clapped on that one. This is going to get rough. Well, God's in control. God is sovereign.
Yes.
God will take care of it. According to my Bible, everything that God does is through man.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah.
So if you don't talk to your family members, how are they going to get saved?
Amen.
Well, Pastor will do it. I don't know your family. You do. But yeah, listen to me. If there was a fire in their house and you pulled up to their house and flames are shooting out, you break in to get them out.
Right.
We are talking eternity here. And we look at our family members and we say, I hope that God saves their soul.
Yes.
And God says, you better start talking to them about me and not worry about how they view you.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
I'm preaching the truth, guys.
Amen.
Listen to me. You've got to wake up. If the church doesn't preach it, where are they going to hear it?
Mm-hmm. Right.
But Pastor, they may not like me. They didn't like Jesus either. And Jesus says, don't go by the faces of men.
Right.
They are going to thank you when they're on the other side and you see them in eternity that you woke them up.
Yes.
So they don't talk to you for a while. So what?
Right.
You are in a spiritual battle for people's souls.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know the enemy hates you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why do you think the enemy hates you so much? Because you are made in the image of God.
Yeah.
He's not. You are. And he hates it.
Yeah.
Because you're redeemed. He's not. Since the beginning of time, there's been a cosmic battle of power. And it rages today. All what this is all about is winning souls. Where is your heart today? If God were to return today, not even return, I'm sorry. If God were to rapture you out right now, how many would still be here? But Pastor, I go to church every week. Pastor, I know Jesus. Pastor, you know, I work in the church. Fantastic. But you didn't know him. His blood didn't cover you. Why'd you say unto me, Lord, Lord, and do not what I ask you to do? Why? Satan, listen, did God create Satan?
Yes.
No. No, no, no. He created Lucifer. He didn't create Satan. Do you know who created Satan? Hello. Every one of us. It's everybody's fault. Every time, listen to me, listen well, and here's where people are going to get mad at me. James 4:17. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good, and does it not, to him it is S-I-N. Hebrews 10:26. For if we sin willfully, not by accident, willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. Well, Pastor, I like sex. You're not married. Oh, but you know, it's okay. You are deceived. You are very much deceived. And when you continue to live that life, guess who you are siding with? The enemy.
Yes.
But I'm a Christian. Not in that area, you're not. You have not yielded that life over to Jesus on that time. You cannot play this game. Your eternal life is hanging in the balance. Yes, God is graceful. But don't think you can do against what the Word of God says willfully and not pay a price for it. There is no more sacrifice for sins when you say, I'm going to do this anyway, and I don't care what this Word says. Oh, you guys are quiet today. Listen. Listen to me, guys. We are in a dangerous time. Yes. Went to Marie Granieri's wake the other day. And joyous. I'm not saying that we're laughing because she passed.
No.
We're very sad that she left us. But our heart was joyful that, man, she's in. She's in glory. She made it. She's home. Healed, delivered, free.
Hallelujah.
And everybody around is not crying, but they're, praise God. Joe, he did the eulogy for his wife, and he gave a half hour sermon.
Wow.
Because they were unsafe people. That's when you know that you know that you know that you're on the right side.
Amen.
You go to some other wakes of people who don't believe, and there's mourning and crying and wailing and no hope and despair and hopelessness. Of course, because where you ended up is an eternal damnation.
Yeah.
Well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. I don't care what you believe. You better believe what this says, and Jesus wouldn't have said it if it wasn't true.
Amen.
Jesus would never send a good person to hell. Bing, bing, bing. Absolutely right. You do it.
Amen.
You send yourself to hell. He doesn't. When you reject the Word of God and say, I'm living my own life.
Amen.
Wrong answer. God will let you do it. God is a gentleman. He'll say, go ahead. Go ahead. Just don't let time run out. The biggest deception today in the church is God's sovereignty. I've just did a study on this. Well, Pastor, God is in control. Yeah. If you go in the dictionary and you understand what the dictionary's terminology of sovereignty is, all-powerful, numero uno, top of the food chain, you're absolutely correct. But God doesn't control everything that happens in your life. How many understand that? That was a hard thing for me to accept. And I'm going to prove it to you. What does the Bible say about salvation? It is not God's will that any should perish. It is not, listen, it is not God's will that any should perish. The Bible also says, narrow is the way to life, broad is the gate to destruction, and many there be that go there.
Yes.
Yes.
Is it God's will? No. But God lets you go because you have free will. So you can't say, oh, it's God's will that they perish. No, because the Bible says it's not His will that any should perish. Well, God allowed ISIS into America. God did not allow any of that. He didn't stop it, but He didn't allow it. Do you know who allowed it?
We did.
The church did. The government did. Everybody else did. But we want to blame God. Well, God, you. No, hold on. Listen to me. There is an evil darker than what you've ever seen or can comprehend that is coming. That is coming. We had a discussion. I had a discussion with Chris a while ago. Discussion with Pastor Mike on this. Walmart. Oh, Pastor, really? Walmart is getting stores together that want to ID you with a chip. Hello?
Yeah.
Does this surprise anyone?
No.
Because the Bible tells you not to accept the mark of the beast.
Amen.
Now hear me, church. The enemy is not going to say, this is the mark of the beast. This is the mark of the... Oh, this is...
Right.
This is for medical purposes.
Yes.
This is to keep your child safe.
Yes.
This is to keep you safe.
Yes.
Yes. Lies, deception. Wake up.
Yes.
Yes.
Your family out there unsaved does not know.
Yes.
You do, and you remain silent. It's like telling them to go to hell and not caring. We stay silent. Well, Pastor, I don't want to offend. You already offend them.
Yeah.
You're a Christian. They already don't care for you.
Right.
They don't want to hear you. They don't believe you. So what does it matter how they look at you?
It's true.
We're so concerned about how our family views us, how our friends view us, and we could care less what God says about it. Church, we're in trouble. We need to wake up. We need to wake up. Feeling good this morning?
Yeah.
A lot of you guys are looking at me shell-shocked. Okay, it's going to get heavier. Where's the battle territory? Right here. Planet Earth. Planet Earth. This is the battle territory. Where's the battleground? Right here. Jesus said, I saw Satan cast down from heaven. Cast down. Where did he end up?
Earth.
Hey, thank you, Jesus. He's down here.
Yeah.
He rules and reigns here.
Yeah.
Not over God. But he's the God of this world. Hello?
Yeah.
There's so much darkness. How can you account for people putting babies in the oven? Our government allowing partial birth abortions. Where they take, and I'm going to get graphic with you, and teens, I'm going to get graphic with you too, because you need to know this. Where they deliver the baby up to the neck, and they stab it in the back. Because the baby's inconvenient. And they want to fund Planned Parenthood.
Yes.
And we stay silent, saying, oh, you know, I can't do anything. Do you have a mouth?
Yes.
Do you have the word? That's all you need.
Yep.
That's all you need. Gay marriage coming up. Want equal rights? You're not equal. In no way are you equal. A man and a man cannot produce a child. A woman and a woman cannot produce a child. Therefore, you are not equal based on what the Bible says. But what do we say? Oh, no. But don't say anything, because we don't want to offend. If I speak the word in love and in truth, it may offend, but it'll wake you up. I may irk you, but the truth is now planted. I'm not saying to go and beat them over the head. They need love, understanding, somebody who's going to sit down with them, break open the word. This is not what I say. It's what the word of God says. Read it for yourself and let the Holy Spirit minister to you. In no way are we to judge, condemn, or anything else. But we need to speak the truth in love. When the doors open. How many understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
This world, I look at it and I say, God, where is it going? He said it's spiraling out of control. And when I lift my children out and my spirit doesn't dwell here anymore, this America is going to be in big trouble. Big trouble. Amen? The battleground is your mind. Teens, listen. You have a lot coming at you. Social media, Facebook, texting, all kinds of junk. This word has to become alive to you, and you need to make it a point to read it. Mom can't make you read it. Dad can't make you read it. I would love to make you read it. But I can't make you read it. It's not our job to make you do anything. It's your job to desire. But you know what? My friends won't like me. So what? You got people that don't like you anyway, right? Every one of you have people that really don't like you. That's the way of the world. The Bible says, woe unto you if everyone speaks well of you. Right? If everybody's speaking well of you, then you might be the two-faced person, because if you're telling people the truth, they're not going to like you. They're not going to like you at all. But it's your responsibility, just like it's our responsibility as adults, to get into this word and get our minds shaped around this word. Romans 12:2 says, don't conform to the things of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So how can you sit and tell me that when you deliberately sin, it's okay? God understands. That's the enemy whispering to your ear saying, did God really say that? Did God really mean that? Did God really say you can't have sex before marriage? Did God really say don't lie? Did God really say don't steal? Yeah. He said it. And just the fact that you have to ask it tells me that you don't know who God is. Because God reveals himself to you in his word. You know what my Catholic friends say to me all the time? I don't know how you can tell me what God wants. Here it is. It's not rocket science. Yeah. You guys go and want to get Windows for Dummies and how to learn how to use a computer. This is what you use to make your life work. Yeah. But we don't do it. We don't tell them. We don't be, we're not faithful.
Yes.
Jesus went everywhere preaching the word.
Yeah.
His disciples went everywhere to preach the word. And we say, Pastor will do it. Jimmy Swagger will do it. Watch Grateful Dollar, he'll do it. Watch this one, he'll do it. Watch Jesse Duplantis, he'll do it. No! No! Lord, send me!
Mm-hmm.
I'll do it!
Yes.
I'll do it. but we don't do it. And we wonder why the church is so weak today. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17:9 that man's heart is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? So getting back to the riots, it doesn't have to be about black people rioting, because I can go into any university and see these crazy white boys flipping cars over because their team won.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Huh. Race issue there? No. Stupidity.
Yeah.
Rebellion. Outright rebellion against God. Period. Ferguson, outright rebellion.
Yes.
Baltimore, outright rebellion. And you know what we do? We sit in front of this magic box.
Yeah.
And we believe everything that our news media, because they wouldn't lie. God, no. Jesus, no. Our news media doesn't lie. It shows people in Baltimore attacking police, but yet it doesn't show that black people and white people linking arms to stop them from hitting the police. Oh, but we've got to believe what the news media says. Do you know who irks me? When I hear saying, story at 11. They can make a cat stuck in a tree seem like the second coming of Christ. You ever hear that? It irks me. Story at 11. What story, you moron? There's nothing there. But we sit there and go, ooh, what's going to happen? Ooh, ooh. I can tell you what's going to happen. The world's coming to an end. And you better be ready. I don't need to go to the news media. It's the end of the world. Is the end of the world coming? You tell me. You watch these rag mags. Prophecies of Jesus coming true. Thank you. Yes. But we still don't believe it. You know, Pastor, it may not be in our time. You know, they were talking about the end times back in Jesus' day.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, you are correct.
Yeah.
You are correct. No man knows the time. No man. But let me tell you something. You had better be ready. The enemy's mission is to dethrone God. Didn't happen. Destroy all creation. You know what I think is interesting? ISIS is Islamic, yes? And if I'm not mistaken, there are three layers of Islam. There's your Sunni. I forgot what the other two were. Shiite and something else, right? There's three. If you're a Sunni, you're the radical. And they kill other Islamists that don't believe like they do. Think about that. Satan is out to destroy creation, and he doesn't care how he does it. He's going to use man to do it. He's going to use man to do it. President Obama, the intelligent man that he is, made a statement that, I'm sorry, you can get me started on that, but here we go. My wife tells me, you're not political, you're a pastor. So yeah, I know. But that could change. Whew! All right. He made a statement at a breakfast that Christians shouldn't ride on their white horses because we were just as bad in the Crusades. You, Mr. President, need to check your history book. Because according to my book, when I read it, the reason why the Crusades took place was because the Muslims were coming into Europe after the Ottoman Empire and slaughtering people.
Yes.
And you have the right audacity to say it's a Christian's fault?
Yes.
Get your facts straight.
Amen.
But yet, we want to believe him because he wouldn't lie either. Your country goes where your leadership takes it. You have a border that was let open for illegals to come in, to go in to your infrastructure, to get on Social Security, never pay a dime into it. How do you destroy a country from the inside out? So I'm going to say there. Deceives the world, and if possible, the very elect. There was this guy, and I laugh because it just shows you how gullible people are. What does the Bible say about false prophets? Don't hear them. If the Bible says this, if it says Jesus is there, don't go. If it says Jesus is here, don't go. This clown gets up and says, I'm Jesus in the flesh. And people flock to him.
Yes, sir.
Are you crazy?
Yes, they are.
And guess who it is? The 85% of the Christians. The 85% that claim to know God are flocking to the very person God says don't go to.
Yes, because they don't read.
Because they don't read. Well, Pastor, how do you know the will of God? You're not a judge. I'm not. He is.
Yes.
I don't get it. I get it. It's the enemy. The enemy's weaponry, darkness. It says in 2 Corinthians 4:4, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelieving so that they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Well, Pastor, you don't know how many times I hear this, and it drives me crazy. Pastor, I believe, but I don't want to be fanatical. Really? You ever go to a football game?
That's true.
You ever go to a baseball game?
Yeah.
Did you ever go to a bridal shower? Ladies, you didn't think you were going to get off that easy, did you? Did you ever go to a wedding? You want to talk about fanatical? Oh, Pastor, I didn't spend a lot of money on this wedding. Just $30,000. Oh! Not fanatical? We're fanatical about everything but Jesus.
Yeah.
Everything that we need to be fanatical about, we're not. Right? We're not fanatical about God, are we? God, no. We don't want to seem crazy. But we have the light of the world that's inside of us. Planet Earth. The battleground. I mean, the battlefield, rather. Satan cannot make you do anything. Hello?
Right.
You ever hear that term, the devil made me do it? Adam, the wife you gave me, she made me do it. No, she didn't. Your stupid self made you do it. Had nothing to do with the enemy. The enemy can only give you a thought. Can't make you do anything. Teens, the enemy can only make you think a thought. He cannot make you do it.
Amen.
Don't buy into this. The enemy, you know, the devil made me do it. No. Rebellion made you do it.
Yes.
Going contrary to the word of God made you do it. But God, I'm sorry, Satan can never make you do anything. Understand that. Understand that. He can deceive you, and that's what he works on. Isaiah 14:7 says to Satan, he who made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities. You have destroyed your land and slain your people. The enemy cares about no human being.
No.
Not one. He'll use you. He'll use anybody who gives him the opening, but he could care less about you. He'll use you, he'll abuse you, and he'll kill you. Yesterday, we went to my daughter's graduation, and the girl I told you about who died back in December, her mom and dad were there, because their daughter was also going to receive her graduation diploma. So I happened to catch them where I was sitting. I could have a vantage point where they were sitting. And as they read her name as she was supposed to walk across the stage, I got mad. I said, God, she got robbed of this. She got robbed of all of this. I went outside, and we were in the car, and I said to my wife, she got robbed of this. And the Holy Spirit quickened me so fast. And he said, that's right. Because your enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I heard, well, you know, God got another angel. You know, God received another angel. God doesn't need any more angels. You are not an angel. When you go to heaven, you are who you are.
Yeah.
You don't turn into an angel. Amen? God didn't need you up there to finish the work. God can do that on his own. But people always say, you know, this is God's will. No, it's not. God doesn't ordain death, does he?
No.
God puts his word above his name, does he not? So it's not God's fault when somebody dies, right? Well, God had to allow a pastor. It wouldn't happen if God allowed it. Did God allow the Twin Towers to come down?
No.
Some of you will say, yeah. He could have stopped it. Yeah, he could have. But evil did it. Evil did it. Satan will use people to do evil. God didn't do it. God didn't allow it. Got nothing to do with it. As a matter of fact, I'm going to tell you a little story. How many remember the Columbine killings in high school? I just read this not too long ago. I heard this on the tape that I was listening to. There was a Bible study, and one of the shooters attended the Bible study. And as this gentleman was doing the Bible study, he stopped and he said, "The Lord is telling me that one of you is contemplating suicide or killing someone." He said it was so strong he couldn't get off it. For a half an hour, he pleaded and pleaded and pleaded that that person come forward for prayer, not do what they were going to do. And a few days after that, the massacre took place. God will put roadblock upon roadblock upon roadblock in your way to stop you from going to hell. But how many know that you can crawl over a roadblock? You can take a detour. And that's what they did. Amen? It's not God's fault. Deception. Their foolish hearts were, this is in, I'm sorry, Romans 1, 22, 23, and 25. Their foolish hearts are destroyed. Professing to be wise, they became fools who exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the creator. Deception. Satan's greatest tool. Did God really say that? And listen to me. As a pastor, I'm human. Hello?
Yes.
I don't have all the answers. I don't know all the answers. I go by that book. If I say something that doesn't sit right with you, it's your responsibility to go home, dig out the truth, search it out for yourself, and ask the Holy Spirit to give you enlightenment on it. Hello?
Yes.
Don't just take what people up in a pulpit or a preaching say at face value all the time, because we can miss it.
Yeah.
But you won't miss it when you sit alone with God at Jesus' feet and say, "Holy Spirit, I need clarity on this.
Amen.
Lead me in this. I need to know about this." And God says, "I am no respecter of persons. What I'll do for one, I'll do for another." How many understand that?
Amen.
But it's your responsibility as a person and a child of God to go and read that word and dig out the truth so you're not deceived. Amen?
Amen.
The next thing the enemy uses is division. Where does he use division the most? Right in the church. Right in the church. Isn't that shameful? The Bible says that we're not ignorant of the enemy's devices, yet he walks right in to a church and starts causing division. Well, you know, I don't think Pastor Stan, all the whispering that starts. I don't think that's right. Shut up. Don't give the enemy any avenue. Go directly to the source. And if you're not comfortable with the source, then go to someone else, another leader, and go to another leader, and then have a meeting. But no, we'll start to divide and conquer. You're not going to stand. A house divided against itself cannot stand. Amen?
Right.
Satan is a liar, and a liar from the beginning. Satan wants to destroy every one of you and every one of you.
Right.
Every one of you he wants to destroy. And he wants your kids.
Yeah.
Pastor Mike was telling us about a play he went to see. What was it?
It was a musical of Shrek.
Shrek. And there was demonic overtones in that play. But yet, we'll take our kids to it.
Yeah.
Pastor Mike said he got so sick about it that if it wasn't that his girlfriend bought the tickets, they would have walked out. The thing is if you don't have discernment, you'll buy right into it. You'll let your kids listen to anything. It's Disney. Disney can't possibly be wrong, right?
Right.
Disney's a kid's show, right?
Yeah.
It is run by sinful man.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
And what way is it better to ruin a culture and a society than to plant seeds in a young child's mind and then walk away?
Yes.
See, that's what Satan does to most of us. He doesn't dog you half the time. All he has to do is come over when you're young and say, you're a loser. Bam. You'll never amount to anything. Bam. You're disgusting. Bam. Plant a seed and walk away. And then over time, guess who Satan has to talk to you about how disgusting you are? Could be mom and dad. Could be friends. Could be situations, teachers. And now the seed gets watered. And now the seed grows to become a dysfunctional adult. But yet, we just let it happen. We don't take time to minister to the sick in the church because we're too busy running out to the cookout we have to go to, to this we have to go to, to that we have to go to. And we don't spend time ministering to the sick of the body. How can people get well if there are no physicians in the house? Jesus is your king physician. But people need to hear it from leadership to get better. Amen? There are some sick people in this house.
Yes.
I talk to you. I know. And when I say sick, I mean wounded. You need healing. You need to understand what the Word of God says about who you are and what your life is all about. And stop going around this foolish mountain. Amen? Even the trees are saying, God, get moving. God is a God of light. I'm going to close with this. God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son for you. Is salvation automatic? No. The Bible says that God gave His only Son that whosoever should believe should not perish. It's your choice. I gave my Son to whomever that you would not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
And the devil's going to come to you and say, a loving God accepts you for who you are. A loving God will never, ever want you to suffer eternity in hell. That makes no sense. And most of us go, yeah, you know what? You're absolutely right. It doesn't make any sense. Yeah, it does. Because if you go to a judge for doing something wrong, yes, you're going to pay a price, yes or no?
Yes.
He is not going to tell you, oh, it's okay. But what God did was, He gave you Jesus.
Yes.
That He says, I'm going to put everything that you did on Him.
Yes.
So that you can be blameless. All you have to do is receive it.
Yes.
All you have to do is say, I accept you, Jesus. Yes. Jesus on the cross took every sin and every judgment against you. So, don't say that God will send you to hell, because He does not. It's you. God wants you saved, healed, whole, well, delivered, prosperous. That's the God that we serve. Think about that. Teens, you are so much of an have so much of an advantage over us old folks here. You guys are what? 14, 15, 16, 17? I'm 53. So you guys got 40 years on me. If you get busy seeking God out earnestly and heavily and with a desire, where you'll be at 53 compared to where I am will blow me away.
Yes.
Yes.
You guys could be walking on water.
Yes.
You guys could be raising the dead.
Amen.
If you get your life straight now.
Amen.
Don't play and say, I have all this time. Go read the obituaries. 22, 23, 25, 19, 18, 14, 16. Just I read the other day, a 20-year-old basketball player who had such high hopes died. 20 years old. That's only 6 years older than you. For some of you, 2 or 3 years older than you. So don't think you have forever, because you don't. You have today, right now, redeem the time, right now. Same with us. Church, I've said it, and I'm going to say it again and again and again until you want to kill me. We need to get moving. It doesn't matter if we're buying the building or if we're not. It matters that we're going out there and winning souls.
Yes.
God will take care of this, but we need to take care of that, because My father's 75 years old. I got to minister to him like I'll never see him again.
Yep.
And the Lord was saying, well, what are you waiting for? Exactly. For the right time. Guess what? Never a right time.
Right?
It's you got the time, today, right now. But he'll get mad. Get mad anyway. What about your family? You got people who are growing old in your family? What are you waiting on?
Time.
What are you waiting on? For Jesus to come down and have a conversation with them?
Yes.
Guess who resides in you?
Yes.
That would be Jesus.
Yes.
Tell your family time. Jesus loves you.
Yes.
You tell me that all the time. Stop saying that. All right. Jesus loves you. It's time to get to know him now. I'm not going to the house anymore. I'll come to you. I'm not saying bug people. I'm just saying there's always present the gospel. Always present it. They're not going to get saved unless they hear the gospel message. And I can pretty much guarantee you they're not going to watch Creflo Dollar.
Right. Right.
They're not going to turn on Christian radio. Unless by God that their radio gets broken and God has an intervention for them. But it's by you and I ministering to them to get them saved. How many understand what I'm telling you?
Yes.
This world is dying. Church, we're called to rise up. Get marching, pray, seek the Lord, stop ministering to people around us, stop caring about what people think, stop caring about what people say. You signed up for it. This is what Jesus said, to endure hardness as a good soldier. You're a Jesus freak. Praise God, but I'm not a Madonna freak.
Yeah.
Amen? How many people do you see on TV that want to be like these people on TV?
Yeah.
Remember when Madonna came out, those cone boobs she had?
Oh.
Great example. Let your teens walk. Matter of fact, let's all dress up like Madonna. Every time you turn around, somebody had these foolish things on. This is not the role model, people. Hello?
No.
But yeah, we'll let our kids watch anything, listen to anything, do anything. I'm not even going to go. That's a whole other sermon. I'll wait on that. But that's our responsibility. Let's all stand. Wouldn't it be great if Jesus actually came down and personally stood here? He'd come down, you'd go out. But do you know that Jesus is in your heart? do you really believe that? Because if you really believe that Jesus resides inside you, then half the stuff that you do, that you willfully sin, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. Jesus has got to become alive and well in you. How many understand that?
Amen.
I'm going to say a prayer. And the teens too. It's like, there's no time to fool around. There just is no time. You guys are embarking, some of you are in junior high school, you're in high school, you're going to be going in. You think it's rough now? Wait. This is, mom and dad can protect you. Mom and dad can do so much for you, but when you get into the schools, boyfriends, girlfriends, the opportunity to drink, the opportunity to have sex, the opportunity to take drugs, the opportunity to get new wave thought, a new age thought, and this thought and that thought, you've got to say no. And you're not going to be able to just by saying, I'm going to do it by self-will. Good luck. That does not work. It does not happen. It happens on a very rare occasion. But you're going to need the power of the Holy Spirit and God working in your life to say no. Because listen, mom and dad, they won't always be with you, right? You guys go out on your own sometimes, right?
Yep.
When your mom and dad aren't there, God is always watching over you. The Holy Spirit is always with you. So if you think you're going to do something and mom and dad won't find out about it, they may not, but God knows about it.
Yeah.
You're never going to get away from God not knowing about what you do. And he always loves you no matter what. But I'm going to ask you guys today. I don't want you to answer this question, but I'm going to ask you today, as well as the congregation. If you die today, are you sure you're going to heaven? Well, Pastor, my mom, I didn't ask you that. I know your mom's saved. I know your dad. I know that. What about you? Are you saved? Are you truly a born-again believer of God? Because the Bible says that you need to confess the Lord Jesus Christ with your mouth.
Yeah.
And don't confess it because we want you to. Confess it because you want to. Because you can pray all you want, but if the prayer is just to appease me, don't say it. That goes for every one of us. Say it because you mean it. Because you want to be transformed. Amen?
Amen?
Every day is a new day to realign with God. Recommit yourself today. We're going to say a prayer, but I want you guys to really think about it. That, hey, if I die today, do I really have a heart for Jesus, that Jesus would take me? Because Jesus loves you. Don't get me wrong. There's no question. But God says, I need to know. I know your heart. Is your heart for or against? That's what you have to decide. People here too. I know you're Christians. I know we're part of the 85% of the Gallup poll. But if God was to rapture the church now, who would be left behind? This needs to be a sobering thought. Because we don't know when the rapture is going to happen. I don't really care if you believe in a rapture or not. I do. In a twinkling of an eye, bam, gone. And woe unto you who are left behind. Woe unto you when the Holy Spirit leaves this place. But are you ready?
Yes.
If the Lord should call us out? That's what you have to know. We're going to say a prayer. Teens, again, don't say it if you don't mean it. Because God knows the heart. But really say it if you mean it. We're going to say a prayer. I want people just to rededicate themselves to what God has called you to do and what God has called you to be. Amen?
Amen?
There is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. It's pick it up and keep moving. Repeating after me. Father, we thank you for your patience, your mercy, and your long suffering. We thank you for your forgiveness. We thank you for the shed blood of Jesus. Father, we know that you're not looking for perfection, but you're always looking for a heart condition, a heart that's for you, in love with you, and surrendered to you. Father, help me through the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome any weak area of my life and allow me to yield it to you. And for areas in my life that I'm deceived in and I don't truly understand or trust your word in that area, I rely on the Holy Spirit to realign my thought and my actions. For those of you who never had the opportunity to invite Jesus Christ into your heart today, I'm going to encourage you not to leave this place until you make yourself right with God, because no man knows. The Bible says life is but a vapor, here today, gone tomorrow. You don't know that if you walk out these doors today, God forbid, you could get hit by a bus, by a car. Anything can happen out there. Don't leave this place without making a commitment to Jesus Christ. For those of you, we're going to all pray together, but for those of you who have never had the opportunity to accept Jesus, we're going to pray together with you. Dear Jesus, come into my heart. Take away all of my sin. Wash me in your precious blood. I receive your free gift of eternal life. I believe that Jesus was killed, was buried, and was risen on the third day, and sits at right hand of God the Father. I thank you for my salvation. I receive it in Jesus' name.
I receive it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Father, I pray, Lord, for the congregation. Father, I pray, Lord, as they depart here today, Father, that you would cause them to be the head and not the tail, cause them to be above and not beneath. Yes. Father, I pray, Lord, for traveling mercies upon them. Yes. Father, I pray, Lord, for a change of heart, mind, and spirit. Yes. Father, I pray, Lord, that the word spoken today will go down not only in their hearts, but in mine also, and let there be a transformation that takes place. And Father, let us minister everywhere we go. Lord, time is running short. Father, you need people out there ministering your word and preaching the gospel of the salvation of Jesus Christ. Amen. Father, I pray, Lord, for the congregation. Be blessed. Go with God, guys. Have an awesome weekend.